Encircled by the Alps and fed by its four rivers, it is a city shaped by kings and emperors, the heart of architecture, industry, and culture. The first Italian center for modern art, philosophy, and fashion. Above it all, the Mole Antonelliana, its spire rising to the heavens. A symbol that is a bridge between city and sky. The home to one of the most unique museums in the world. An homage to man's dream of recreating reality. The birth of Italian cinema began here in this city of automobiles, chocolate, vermouth, and the Holy Shroud. Destroyed by Hannibal and turned into a fortress by Julius Caesar, this city was Italy's first capital and now hosts the 20th Olympic Winter Games. This is 26-year-old Joey Cheek of the United States as he prepares for his first event, the 500 meters. 37 athletes representing 12 countries will compete for the gold medal here in Torino. Cheek will compete in three events, the 500, the 1,000, and the 1,500 meters. This is his second Olympic appearance. 4 years earlier at the Salt Lake City Olympics, he competed in the same three events, winning a bronze medal in the 1,000 meters.
You think your first Olympic experience is going to be just this amazing, thrilling ride or whatever. And I have to say, Salt Lake City for me was pretty amazing, but that year was probably the most miserable year of my life. For weeks and months leading into the Olympics, you know, you'd have insomnia, wake up in the middle of the night, you're just thinking about, oh God, I got to do this time at practice tomorrow. I've got to do, you know, I've got to beat this person or beat that person. And it's a very difficult way to live. It's not a healthy way to live. I won a bronze medal, obviously, so I was, you know, I'd never won a medal before. And I got done and I said, well, that wasn't worth it. It wasn't worth killing myself that much just for that medal. And so I said from that day forward, I'll skate as long as this is what I love doing.
As kids, Joey and his brother Michael were nationally ranked inline skaters. Along the way, their parents taught them values that complemented their athletic talent.
The one thing my parents have always said was that they care how we treat people. One time I remember when I was younger. I was really good as an inline skater, cockiest kid you ever met, and had to get some award, and I didn't get quite, I maybe was second or third, not what I wanted to be, and I took my helmet off and slammed it. My mom grabs me, and she goes, "If I ever see you slam your helmet again, or if I ever see you not carry yourself with dignity up there, I'll never bring you to another skating meet as long as you live." And she goes, "You know, there are 50 other kids who skated there this weekend, and you're lucky enough and fortunate enough to be able to stand on the podium and win." She goes, "You damn well better make sure that you respect those kids who didn't win and who want it just as bad as you do, and not share that kind of attitude." So she pretty quickly on made sure that we realized that there's bigger things out there than being first, second, or third.
While watching the 1994 Lillehammer Games, 14-year-old Joey was inspired by Norway's Johan Olav Koss, who won 3 gold medals and donated his prize money to the children of war-torn Sarajevo. Koss later went on to form Right to Play, a foundation that brings sports and education to third world countries.
In 1994, I watched the Olympics with Johan Koss, and I looked at my mom and I said, "You know, Mom, I want to be a speed skater." And so she said, "Well, you're not going to be able to do it here." So really, my mom and dad, they let me pack my bags at 16 and head off to Calgary, Canada.
Now here in Torino, Joey's first event will be the 500 meters. Each competitor will skate twice. The race is 1.25 laps around the 400-meter oval. Though Joey won the World Sprint Championships just 1 month earlier, he is not considered the only favorite. Also favored is 19-year-old Dmitry Dorofeev of Russia, who finished second behind Cheek at the World Sprint Championships. And another is Jeremy Wotherspoon of Canada, winner of the 500-meter World Cup title in 7 of the past 8 years. Joey is matched with Wotherspoon in the 17th pair. The competition begins. The 500 meters is considered the equivalent to the 100-meter dash in track and field, a competition won by quick starts and all-out speed to the finish. The gold medal is awarded to the athlete with the fastest combined time after 2 races. As each pair goes off, the slow Torino ice takes its toll. After 16 pairs, Dmitry Dorofeev of Russia leads the field with a time of 35.24 seconds. Now the 17th pair. Joey Cheek will start on the inside.
My favorite moment in skating is right when you step to the line. So you've got all this pressure, all this stuff going on, this big warm-up, and you're doing this routine that you've done 1,000 times to get ready for the Olympics. And the starter calls you up. You say, "Go to the start."
Go to the start.
The whole crowd just gets still. And I look down the lane, take this big breath, and I look down the line, and then it's just me and the ice. It's like the perfect moment where you're just you doing what you love doing. Star says ready, and you go down in the position. Boom, the gun goes off. And for that next 34 seconds, or for that next minute, or that minute 45, however long that event is, there's nothing in the world but you doing what you love doing.
At the crossover, Joey's split time is the fastest of the day.
I raced that first race against Jeremy Wotherspoon, who's like 3-time World Sprint Champion. And we raced, and I skated a great race and crossed the line. And I looked at the board, and I thought I had done his time. And I see, whatever, a few hundred slower than the current leader, and shoulders kind of slump. And then I look up again, and I see my time. I see this, like, look of surprise cross my eyes, and arms go up, and I'm so excited.
Cheek moves into first place, the only competitor to skate under 35 seconds. In the second heat, the skaters with the slowest times will skate first.
Come on, come on.
Joey will skate in the final pair. He will be matched with Lee Kang-Seok of Korea in third place. The current leader is Dmitry Dorofeev of Russia. Joey needs a time of 35.76 seconds to defeat Dorofeev.
Stepped on line to race the second heat, the 500, and I'm racing the Korean guy. We skate down the first 100 in the first corner. Now, obviously, there's tension there because you carry it all through your head and your neck, and you kind of feel like, all right, I'm in position to win the Olympics.
Joey Cheek is again the only skater to break the 35-second barrier. He wins the gold medal. Dmitry Dorofeev of Russia, the silver. Lee of Korea, the bronze. As he skates his victory lap, Joey contemplates what his gold medal will provide. An opportunity similar to that of his childhood idol, Johann Olav Koss.
Going into the Olympics and the weeks leading up to it, I was skating so well, and I was like, you know, I might actually pull this off. I don't want to get too overconfident here, but I actually have a shot to maybe be a gold medalist. And so I wanted to make sure when I had that moment, I wanted to do something big. So I talked to the Right to Play folks before the Olympics. And so finally they said, you need to talk to Johan. Wow, you know, this hero of mine who I started watching when I was 13 or 14 years old, became a speed skater because of him. But he sets up an hour to meet with me.
I was always impressed by him as a speed skater. And going from that meeting, I was even more impressed of him as a human being. And he wanted to do something for the world. He thought he could have a moment to make a difference.
So I'm skating around and somebody throws a flag. So I'm getting to carry the flag. And then I see Johan. And so he tosses me the red Right to Play ball. And I get to carry that and the flag around. And now I'm getting ready to go to my press conference and hopefully raise a ton of money for them and raise awareness about this other area of the world that has absolutely nothing to do with the Olympics.
Later that evening at the awards ceremony, Joey Cheek receives the gold medal. Before the ceremony, he announced he would donate his $25,000 prize money to Right to Play.
He came to the press conference tonight. What I've heard, they started talking about the race and said, you know what, I really want to focus about what Right to Play is doing in Chad for the Darfur refugees and the situation in Darfur, and he wanted to contribute his bonus money, which he got from the United States Olympic Committee. And I heard that you could hear a pin drop. The room got so quiet, and the focus was totally changed. Joey became, in my eyes, the true role model of Olympic athletes. That you can achieve the best, but you can also give back in the sense of giving back to the most vulnerable children in the world.
5 days later, Joey would win the silver medal in the 1,000 meters. Again, he donates his prize money to Right to Play. His total gift of $40,000 is an inspiration for athletes, sponsors, and fans around the world. Because of his generosity, the United States Olympic team selects Joey Cheek to carry the U.S. flag in the closing ceremonies.
After Joey's announcement, it was an enormous impact. People calling from all around. We got emails from children, from parents, and how they could help out. They were organizing small events, they were doing fundraising, they were trying to match Joey's donation. We got corporations calling us, foundations calling us, and saying, you know what, this is the most inspiring moment of the Olympics. If we raised over $500,000 US dollars in the United States, it inspired Clara Hughes, the Canadian gold medalist, to give her money. Yang Yang, the first Chinese gold medalist in the Winter Olympics in 2002, she participated and won the bronze medal in Torino. She committed to give her bonus money to Right to Play. We have seen this incredible impact worldwide in the sense of what he started. And it's been just fantastic for us as an organization.
It seems unfair that so many of us in the US are blessed with so many opportunities and gifts and chances to chase our dreams for something that is really ultimately a pretty small deal. I mean, as much as I'm thrilled and honored to become an Olympic champion, it's a much more personal thing. I'm grateful that I had the support and family that let me do this, but it's not gonna matter in 10 years or 20 years or 5 years. We're just lucky, all right, you're born in the US, you have things. You're born in this part of Europe, you have things. Oh, sorry, you're born in Africa. Your family's killed and you may die of HIV when you're 25. And so ultimately it was sort of this search for doing something more important or more meaningful. And the Olympics for me was twofold. One, it was this chance to do the thing that I love. And then the other thing was it was like a very big microphone. So I was able to take this thing that I love and I was able to use it for something that I think is more meaningful. Even if I never meet any of these kids who get to work in these right to play programs, this is something that I think will help someone else's life.
Mes sundos.